Okay, so finally, I'm now in the middle of Tokyo and Hokkaido. I really enjoy it. It's a great place. What I'm going to do here is recently I've been actually working on this for quite a long time, for about 10 years. Last year we put out some paper on a sort of mathematical construction of something called gauge linear segment model. And so it would be a good opportunity to talk a little bit, give you some kind of motivation, why you want to do this here. So besides, you can use stock. And so, would be a good opportunity for students who want to work on this. So I try to, kind of make it some kind of advertisement about this. So talk about gauge linear segment model. We really have to go back to like a Calabi manifold. So to tell you why we want to do this. So let me just give you a few minute history of Calabi manifold. Why it's so interesting. The one dimensional Calabi manifold is very easy. So we learned this in the kind of first year graduate course. There's something called uniformization theorem of a complex one-fold, or the real two-dimensional manifold is a genus zero is a sphere, then genus one is torus, and then high genus there's a one for each genus. I'm talking about oriented manifold. So this is about a topological classification. If you are they are all complex manifold. If you're interested in complex manifold, then on sphere there's a unique complex structure. In the torus, there's actually one family, one complex family or complex structure you can actually express in terms of equation. In P2, they can be embedded in P2 as a qubit. It turns out, I was kind of joking about when I gave this talk in Tokyo. In Chinese history, we have this great philosopher Confucius. His point of view is that middle is always the best way. So I draw the picture. What is base one? Is one in the middle. It turns out this one is the most interesting complex one for. Also appear a lot in number theory. They actually have a name called elliptic curve. So this is a one-dimensional complex manifold. That's the middle one is one, is a sort of base one. We call elliptic curve. Now it's time to give you a definition of a Calabi manifold. The Calabi manifold is a n-dimensional complex manifold such that if you take a complex cotangent bundle or tangent bundle the same thing, you take a nth wedge product. So this is a complex line bundle. There's a name for that. It's called canonical bundle. If you are low a little bit algebra geometry, you are assuming this is a trivial. So this is a kind of formal definition of a Calabi manifold, namely the canonical bundle is trivial. Now by classification, uniformization theorem, the one-dimensional complex Calabi manifold is exactly complex torus with one of those complex structures. If you want to know which complex structure you have. Now to go to two dimension, this is also fairly classical. This has a name for K called the K3 surface. By the way, there's something called K2 surface as well. This is a picture of a K2 surface. This actually is the second highest mountain in the world. It's located between the Pakistan and China. It's a best looking mountain. It's better looking than Mount Everest. So in mathematics, we have something even better. We call K3 surface. We have one more K. This K3 is three people: Kuman, Kaler, and Kodara. Again, this is a two-dimensional complex manifold where the canonical bundle is trivial. This has been studied for 100 years as well. This is also a single family, but in this case, is actually a 20-dimensional family of K3 surface. If you talk about like a topological classification, just a smooth manifold which animate a Calabi structure, then there's only one. Over that topological full manifold, there's a 20 family of complex structure. The picture is fairly similar to one-dimensional case. So there's one family, but it's much bigger, the 20-dimensional. This has been known for a long time, well over 50 years. So before physicists come in, impression we got is like how manifold is very beautiful, they are pretty rare. One reason they are beautiful is also because they are rare. There's not that many, examples, blah, 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 and so on. They, as I say, until physicists come in, kind of spoil the picture. What a physicist did is they are interested in collabial threefold. The reason they are, why this is kind of common, kind of important in collabial threefold is that the building block of a string universe. Namely, if you kind of like string theory, there's a model for universe. That universe is not four dimensional, it's 10 dimensional. So how should you view about this? You say, you imagine, you have an infinite powerful telescope or microscope. Then you try to resolve a point in space-time. Say this is a point. You try to resolve them. You kind of zoom in. Infinite power, you kind of zoom in. Then this point will become a six-dimensional manifold or three-dimensional complex manifold. Actually, I have a collabial structure. Only 1/10? Even you zoom in 1/10 millimeter, you will say him?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So you will say this person, this is Professor Yao. I think he will be here like, in July. obviously, he's very happy about it. Right? He's hanging there. what is the physicist kind of crazy about is they completely spoil what we thought about collabial manifold. They went in looking for this example. Actually technically it's not so hard. We mathematics can find ourselves as well. We just never did try. We had this impression the collabial threefold are just maybe just only few. Certainly more than one. We know already. There are more than one example, but nobody really expects there will be so many. Maybe Maxim can correct me. When I talk to me, for example, Mori, that was kind of impression we got. You said that just maybe just a few examples. Then it turns out that's not the case. The physicists actually went in to construct some example, like in a weak Fourier space, for example. They come as the millions of a collabial threefold. I see. They sort of inflated. They inflated. Okay. What they did kind of remarkable. Next is they sort of plug the I think it's Cauchy number on the map. This is a sort of geography of collabial threefold. Then up here you look at this kind of pattern. There's some kind of symmetry actually along in the middle. This is sort of beginning of mirror symmetry. So this stuff is kind of too many for taste of our mathematician. On the other hand, they bring you something very interesting. There are many examples. There's some symmetry here. For the last 20 years, has a lot of people try to understand this mirror symmetry mathematically. Where Maxim obviously is a driving force for this investigation. Okay, where are those? You said the 60,000? Those 60,000 collabial threefold. Well, as I said, they're actually not so difficult to study. It's all kind of very classical in algebra geometry. You look at the kind of easiest example, this is a quintet threefold. This is a degree 5 hypersurface in CP4. So you pick up any kind of degree 5 homogeneous polynomial, this gives you a collabial threefold. Now, for my purpose of my talk, I'm writing CP4 as a quotient of C5. You take up a zero model by C star. So this description is going to come up later when I talk about gauging linear signal model. Then next easiest example, which we also know before physicists tell us anything, is you look at the intersection of four quadrants in CP7. This is so-called complete intersection. This is also a collabial manifold, which have a different Hodge number from the first one. So it's certainly different from the quintet. Then you come to be, you can also be a little bit more clever. Instead, you know, when you look in a projective space, you look at the weight projective space. What this example, physicist plot, those are happen to be, if you have, I think it's just hypersimple weight projective space. So you have some kind of weights. Weights is coming instead, so you have a system acting on C5. Instead of a weight 1111, you have a different kind of weight. This generally, then you can take some kind of hypersurface there. This in general will be some kind of overflow, but you can take a so-called Kuiper resolution. In three-dimensional case, there's always a Kuiper resolution. So this gives you a collabial, smooth collabial sweep. Then more generally, you can instead quotient by one C-star action, you can quotient by many C-star action. This come into so-called category, so-called toric variety. You can take a competing section or toric variety. So for a long time, basically all the examples are coming in this kind of fashion. It's like a competing section of a toric variety. Except recently, there are some more interesting, there are some interesting examples coming in a new way. Okay, so what do we try to compute? For those collabial manifold. Well, as I say, of course, you can compute the Hodge number. This is a simplest kind of invariance. You want to go deeper, kind of probe into a deeper structure, which might be useful in physics. The next layer of structure is a counting curve. This is roughly speaking, is coming from you sort of study the string propagation in space time. String theory. In string theory, you replace a point by a string. It's like a loop or could be path as well. And then you watch this loop kind of propagate it in string, in space-time. They're going to interact, so they join, also separate it. Then you kind of sweep out a two-dimensional manifold. This is the open one, this is a closed one. In collabial manifold, this will carry a homomorphic structure. So naturally, the homomorphic curve appear in string theory. Particular homomorphic curve in collabial manifold. One important invariance is a counting them. There are two versions. Like a closed one. This is the origin of a homomorphic invariance or quantum cohomology. Then this open one has been sort of initiated by Maxim. They lead to some kind of category or Foucault category, for example. In this talk, I'm just going to focus on close one, namely how to compute those Gomotian invariants. This is just a kind of very kind of intuitive picture of what they come. If you are a mathematician, well, physicist, you're done, right? So you want a counting curve. But when you actually try to look at a manifold, collabial manifold, counting them, you realize this actually is quite complicated because the first curve does not appear as a discrete. So generally, they form into a family. The dimension also could vary. If you look at the moduli of a homomorphic curve, there are many components with different kind of dimensions. It's kind of complicated business. Took us actually quite a long time to settle down a OK definition. Kind of OK definition is based on kind of following moduli space, the so-called moduli space, a stable map. As I say, we want counting homomorphic curve. The homomorphic curve can be thought as image of a homomorphic map from a Riemann surface. So this is Riemann surface, then you map into, say, this is your collabial manifold. You want to count it, map, homomorphic map from Riemann surface. As I would say, generally this is not discrete, this is some higher dimensional space. It's even worse, this is not compact. Even discrete, there may be even in points, then how do you get a finite number? So first order business is you compatibilize them. There has been quite a long time for us coming to this very good compatibilization proposed by Maxim. It's called moduli space stable map. This is even more complicated. You have your boundary. We also have example. For example, this so-called boundary, the bar, actually have some component whose dimension is even larger than interior. So it's kind of very bad situation. Highly singular. It's a very technical say how to make sense of this counting. It took about 10 years to settle down a OK definition. something we call virtual fundamental cycle. Then afterwards, of course, how to compute it? Then try to match the prediction from physics. The computation itself is also very complicated, unfortunately. I guess, you know, if a problem is too complicated, there's also plus size, the sort of stimulant economy, right? So we'll come write papers, get a tenure. If a problem is simple, you solve overnight, then you lost your job. You can look at it both ways. For example, for the simplest kind of carbon manifold, like a quintet sweep, let's say I take this equation, a Fermat equation, your Gomot invariance depends on two parameters, the genus, also something called a degree. This generally is a rational number. Right? So you realize right from there right away, right, it's not something simple. It's not like a 1, 2, 3. It's some kind of rational number. The degree zero case, the simplest one is the genus 0, degree 1. This geometrically is the number of lines on the Calabrian manifold. This has been computed or can be computed more than 100 years ago. This come up this number 2875. The next one is already very big. It's a I don't have a number with me. I think it's like a 60 million something like that. Even computer degree zero invariance. This has been a major deal in the 90s. Physicists use mirror symmetry as a prediction about those number degree genus zero degree d was solved in the middle 90s by Gimentel and Liu Liang Yao. So in the 90s, it's considered to be a major achievement in mirror symmetry to compute the degree genus zero Gomot invariant of quintet, for example. Then took another 10 years to compute genus one. Was done by Zinger in the middle of 2000. He wrote a serious paper on this subject. After that, it has been another 10 years. Actually no progress in genus 2, for example. It's not nobody working on that. Actually, people does that, try to do that. This modular space stable map, this space is getting so complicated. The older technique is a kind of auto control. So far, we still don't have anything in genus 2. I should mention here, this is a physical prediction by Clem's group, his Albrecht Clem, and his collaborator up to genus 51. One of our goals is try to catch him. So far, well, unfortunately, I actually had a bet with him. He's still winning, unfortunately. Okay. So that's where this gauging linear signal model come in. Studying stable map, computer virtual fundamental cycle just getting so hard. Even when genus equal to 2, we have to develop some kind of new technique. Then this new technique is also originated from physics. It's called gauging linear signal model. The idea there is utilize, here I purposely write in my ambient space is quotient by C star. The phase star is some group action. In physics, it's called gauge theory. Then we try to utilize this group action. This is a model proposed by Witten in the early 90s, actually. It's called gauging linear signal model. That will be the kind of focus of my talk today. I found out this drawing of this is Witten, by the way. I found this online 3 years ago. I think disappeared now. You cannot find it anymore. I really like it.
It's based on the picture. I mean, this drawing is based on the picture. It's not the real drawing.
Okay. Well, I think it's better than the picture, actually. It's really cool. This other person here is a Kentaro Hori in IPMU. He's also a physicist. He's my TA, my gauging linear signal model TA. I learned a lot from him. I've been talking to him over way more than 10 years about this model. Unfortunately, he didn't like this picture. I couldn't find anything else. He asked me to take down his picture. I said no. Do you have a copyright? He didn't have a copyright, so I don't have to take that. Okay, so let me just give you a brief idea of how does gauge linear second model works. I already mentioned one key ingredient is we wanted to write a CP4 as a quotient by C star, as some kind of C star action. So the gauge linear second model depends on this presentation here. It's not just your original manifold. Generally, if you have different kind of presentation, you might actually have a different theory. So another kind of key point in grading, actually very clever construction is a instead looking directly the hypersurface in CP4 given by this equation, you try to extend this into a larger model by adding an extra variable here. So initially the CP4 is a quotient of a C5. You take out something called discriminant. Here is the origins. Now you add another variable you call P. So this is like more like a C6 model by C star. This defining equation, you replace this defining equation by a polynomial so something we call superpotential. Is in this case is P times your original defining equation. This quintile polynomial. But we don't set them equal to zero. We just view this as a function. But on a larger space, on this larger space, with extra variable the p here, the way the weights here it was chosen in such a way this w is a c star invariant. You see, reason I need to pick up the weights of p as minus five is exactly make this as a c star invariant. So the w now would be a function on this polarity actually. This total variety is simply just a total space O minus 5 over CP4. Yeah. The P is a fiber coordinate here. What is good about this is talk about this so-called gauge linear second model. So give rise of a Landau-Kinzer model. Now, instead of studying the zero of the defining equations, you study the critical points of your superpotential. Then in this case, you can compute the critical points of W, you take a partial derivative and set them equal to zero, you realize the critical points is exactly this hypersurface, quintile hypersurface located in the zero section of this bundle. So by doing this, you change the problem. Instead of studying the hypersurface, you study the critical points of some homomorphic function on a larger space. If you can change your problem to the critical point something, it's always a good idea. It's always good to do that. Let me kind of repeat again. So here, the gauge linear second model, first, you really want to look at this the sister action. Also, you're extending your model. You instead talk about hypersurface, you talk about critical points or some function. Kind of one benefit to look at this larger model is another theory kind of related to Gormoni theory. That's because when you look at this quotient here, this space here is you take out a zero from C5, but you don't have to always do that. In fact, you can look at this general question. So how do I construct quotient of C5 called C by C star with this weight, with this this particular weight I'm choosing here. So this is getting into the problem of a GIT quotient. There are more than one GIT quotient actually. One of them is you take off zero from C5, then this obtain your original model with a total space O minus I or P4. Then don't forget it, we have a superpotential on this space whose critical points is your original quintile hypersurface. This other GIT quotient you can remove zero from C. Then you get this model. Then you can sort of cancel out the C slashing, or in other words, you can use the C slashing to rescale the P to one, for example. Then because your weights on P is minus five, So there's a residual action there, Z phi. So this model is equivalent to C phi modeled by Z phi. Since your risk of P equal to 1, your W become your quintet polynomial. So you get this simple looking like a model. It's called Langevin's model, actually. So those two different models are just so-called different phases of gauge indicing model or GIT coefficient. How do you know you have a different construction? There are actually two different kind of construction. Either in algebraic geometry, you need to pick some polarization, or if you have some patch geometer, there's a moment map that's basically given by different coefficient of different kind of liberal size for the regular value. Over this model, we have a Gomolin theory that take many years to establish. For this model, we have another theory, actually also took us 7 years to build a kind of curve counting theory. This is something called FJW theory. It's also like a involved Riemann surface and so on. It's very similar to Gomolin theory. Between those two models, this is a conjecture from physics called the Nahn-Dahl-Günzburg Calabi-Yau correspondence. It's in the same way you have like a mirror symmetry. It's a kind of relation between two different physical models. This side is called the Nahn-Dahl-Günzburg model, and this side is called the Calabi-Yau model. The conjecture relation actually is very interesting. It's very different from what we considered before. For example, like a mirror symmetry, let me first set up what we mean here. It's a, instead of looking at the number, you want to look in so-called generating function. If you want to compute infinite many number, it's always a good idea to formally put some kind of variable here, say like Q for a degree. Then this, a lot of times this actually kind of converge. So you get an analytic function with a Q as a variable. So this is we call a generating function. Initially, this is just like a formal power series. But many times, they converge, then you get some kind of analytic function. For this other theory, you can also define, also dependent genus. And the other variable is not a degree, but there's kind of something kind of similar. You can also define a generating function in the same fashion. Put some kind of formal variable here. The mirror symmetry is a statement about you have a generating function from Gomolin theory. You also have a generating function from B model. Then the mirror symmetry is a statement. Those two functions are the same after a change of variable. That's basically the content of mirror symmetry. But Nahn-Dahl-Günzburg Calabi-Yau correspondence is very different. They are not the same. They are not the same by a change of variable. Rather, they are sort of kind of expansion of the same analytic function and at different points. So here is very important we treat this as an analytic function. Because we didn't converge, it's total analytic continuation. So here, the analytic continuation is naturally come into play. So this is kind of very interesting, the conjecture. We actually use analytic continuation. This naturally leads to something called modular form. Exactly because of your considered analytic continuation. As I say, this is also a famous correspondence for physics. Has been last couple years has been out of work to prove this. In genus zero, we have many results. Your status actually kind of similar to mirror symmetry. Genus zero, we have a lot of technical computing, so we can prove theorem. And high genus generally is still unknown. Part of the reason is that, again, we it's kind of hard to compute. But we do believe, though, it's easier to compute FJW theory than Gomolin theory. There are many kind of supporting evidence. For example, like a modular space here is much, much simpler than a stable map. Okay, so now this coming to this kind of gauge indicing model. The roughly speaking, gauge indicing model is a model kind of interplay between those the Gomolin and FJW theory. I already mentioned this is first proposed by Witten in 1993. as a two-dimensional topology quantum field theory for companion section of GIT coaching. Unlike Gorman theory, is with the target of arbitrary column manifold, this is sort of specialized to the companion section of a GIT coaching. Well, but on the other hand, you know, this millions of a collab, well, 60 some collab manifolds that all computing section total, right? Anyway, so this doesn't really restrict yourself. There are many ways to view this, there are several ways to view this. If you are interested in PDE, the one way to think about that, this model is solving a differential equation called gauge weighting equation. By the way, the Gorman theory is about a debye equation. The homomorphic map from Riemann surface into your Calabrian manifold. What is that difficult for that model is your target is some nonlinear space. Your equation is linear, but the target is nonlinear. This is the worst nonlinearity than nonlinearity of equation. So the FGW theory is about this equation. We call it a weighting equation. It's a debye plus a nonlinear term building out of a superpotential. The gauge linear segment model is you have another equation for coming from a gauge theory. The here A is a connection of some principal bundle of a curve. So C is a Riemann surface, you have some principal bundle. The A is a connection over this principal bundle. F here is equivalent map from total space of principal bundle into your V is where you take a GIT quotient. The gauge weighting equation have two equations. The first one is a normal weighting equation. The second one actually is we already know quite a bit. It has been studied quite a lot in the 80s, connecting to stable bundle on Riemann surface. So the second equation is actually is something we're more familiar with. All right. So the special case, as I say, has been studied already in the literature. Before I move on. Let me mention here, you can actually have a parameter here, have a free parameter here in the equation. You sort of use this parameter can interpolate between two different theories. This is exactly this kind of physics way to do analytic continuation, so vary this parameter. Okay, before I go on to kind of construct, give you a construction of the modular space, you know, what it counts for, let me just talk about a few special cases. For the one case is a group is finite. If a group is finite, then of course you don't have this equation. This equation is vacuous. You only have that equation. That's something called weighting equation. We have been studying for 7 years and build a theory for that. This is the sources of FGW theory. Then another special case is a W equal to zero. There's no superpotential. So this term can drop off. You only have a d bar plus it's a curvature equation. And this equation also has been studied since the 90s. All this actually have quite a long history. It's a called the Sampai vertex equation. Has been studied by Solomon and some other people for quite a long time. First in analysis, then also in algebraic geometry, last couple of years by King, Bongsui King, and Yong notes. It's a beautiful theory in algebraic geometry called stable coefficient or quasi map. This has been actually quite popular right now to algebraic geometry counterpart of this equation. An even more ancient story is you don't have F, namely, you don't have first equation, just a second equation. This corresponding to a stable bundle of Riemann surface. This has been actually quite popular in the late 80s and early 90s when I was a student. Actually, a lot of friends who study stable bundle of curve. So now is not so popular anymore. Probably now you don't see that many papers. But it has been a kind of hot topics when I was younger. Well, now we're going to have a theory actually contain all of them. A new ingredient here is there's a parameter R. So you can vary the parameter. Then this introduces some Wolkowson phenomena. So this parameter, in some interval, the theory doesn't change, But when you cross certain certain number, then you have different theory. This is called Wolkerson. This Wolkerson actually is the same kind of Wolkerson as people like Maxim or Subberman talk about. It's just in a different context. I think even location wall should be the same. So those are the kind of four major ingredients in the theory. Now we're going to construct theory contain all of them. So let me set up the problem. Basic data, I mentioned intuitively, this gauge linear model is a theory, is something like a Gormulin theory with a target as a computer section of GIT quotient. So let me first set up the GIT quotient. So this is a first page is the data, first tool is the data to set up the GIT quotient. I'm using sort of algebra geometry language. If you are some SymPy geometer, you prefer some SymPy geometry, you can rephrase this as a internal SymPy geometry in terms of a Hamiltonian group action on SymPy manifold, you have moment map and then level set, that kind of stuff. Algebra geometrically, we have a reductive Lie group acting on complex vector space. We restrict ourselves to a complex vector space. This is the word, this word linear come from. We talk about gauge linear sigma model. Gauge is a group action G. Linear is referred to this as just complex vector space. Then sigma is a map. To talk about, I should mention, although the theory actually can be easily applied to the case V is an affine variety. Let me just restrict to the linear case. So you have a reductive Lie group acting in a complex vector space. So now you want to kind of formulate defining quotient of V mod by G. Is 1-0 back to Hilbert. If you take a if naive take a quotient, this space is not even Hausdorff. So this is a theory developed by Mumford in the 70s, tell you how to remove certain so-called unstable points. Then remaining open subset, your quotient by G, you obtain some kind of algebraic variety. So the process is doing this. You say you need an additional ingredient called polarization. If this is a variety, means you need to pick out some kind of line bundle of your variety. Since V is a vector space, this just a character of G. Since people may not be familiar with this, so let me just tell you roughly how things go. So this VSS is a set of semi-stable points. So what is the set is a, you have this character. Now you look at the theta equivalent polynomial. Theta equivalent polynomial. Then the semi-stable points, the semi-stable just means there are some theta equivalent polynomial such that the value of that point is non-zero. The definition of itself is not so complicated. What the kind of technique come in is prove this set is an algebraic variety, often algebraic variety. Obviously dependent theta because you use this to pick up the so-called semi-stable points. You have different kind of character. Set of semi-stable point will change. So you get a kind of different GIT quotient that are so-called birational to each other. All right, so those two data is the one you needed to define GIT quotient. If you're only interested in the GIT quotient, that's it. You don't need the super potential. The super potential is for you to consider like a computing section or hypersurface or computing section or toroid. This is in the form of a superpotential, which is inherent on a G, as I mentioned before. So this is not quite the same as a defining equation. For example, Quintet, I talk about you extend it by another variable, right? Then you can define your superpotential, then your computing section will appear as the critical points of the superpotential, rather than by some kind of defining equation. I will say here, this is not the, your hypersurface is not W equal to zero. This is not a defining equation. Rather, your hypersurface appear as a critical locus of W. All right. Now, okay. So this is the data to define the GIT quotient. This superpotential is enable you to consider the a hypersurface, for example. Now, to make sure that the model is well defined, let me the later. For example, I'm going to define some kind of modular space. The key property that one of the modular space to have is compact. This you need to have some additional assumption. This assumption is a again is a have a three key property. The first one, which is in some sense is the most important one, is a, I want a critical locus to be compact. This is directly related to the property of my modular space is compact or not. Then this another property called R charge. If you look at physics literature, it's not so visible actually. Yeah, you can easily kind of skip it, but it turns out this take me a while actually to also to understand it's important to have this property as well. That's why I was saying, you know, the Kentaro is my TA because I can keep going back to ask him questions. The R charge is another sister action such that your superpotential have long zero degree. I already mentioned my superpotential needed to be G invariant. So if you think this is a, if you think G is your homogeneity, then W will have degree zero. Now we have we need to have another sister action such that W have non zero degree. The physicists prefer to normalize in such a way that W have a degree two, but for mathematicians it doesn't matter. Then we have some kind of compatibility condition between this C star R with your G action. You can if you you can ignore this in this moment before you become expert. Then the third condition is important at least right now in order to extract numbers from or counting something as a number we need this quotient to be Denning-Mumford or to be orbifold. This is the same thing to say this. S means stable, SS means semi-stable. This condition means low strictly semi-stable points. What happens if you have a strictly semi-stable points is that this is not going to be orbifold, rather have some kind of larger isotropic group, or they call it Artin stack. One interesting kind of phenomena in physics is a dropping number three actually leads to some very interesting development in physics. This go into the world of collapsible manifold, which are not the computing section of total variety or the GIT quotient. Yeah, if I have time, I will kind of come to that. So the continuous way is not a written in the stone. Actually, right now we want to drop them. We have not yet been able to drop them, but it looks like something interesting will happen if you try to drop the third condition. Okay, so this is an example of a gauge linear signal model for collaborative hypersurface of wave projected space. I already talked about quintet. If you have wave projected spaces, this is very similar. You extend it, you have additional variable equal p. Then the weights is signed in such a fashion, your w is p times g here. It's important. You should define superpotential first. It's always like p times g. G is your polynomial. Oh, I guess I use a very bad notation here. Use G both for group and also for polynomial. I probably should change it as F. So the guiding principle is that you want a W to be G invariant. So that uniquely determines what kind of ways you should choose for your P. It's always like that. Then the R charge, the choice is not unique. So as I said, you want to choose a sixth action in such a way the W have some non-zero degree. There are two obvious choices here. For example, you can have a P have a degree zero, or other variable has your older degree, then the W have degree D. Or you can choose a X variable have a degree zero, P have a degree one. This is another R charge here. then turns out the theory actually is independent from which R charge you choose. Now let's compute the critical locus. As I said, this is important. We want a critical locus to be compact, for example. It's very easy to compute them. This is just a calculus. You take a partial derivative, you set them equal to zero. Then turns out there are sort of two components. Depends on P is zero or not. It's either P equal to zero, G equal to zero, or P is not zero, then partial derivative of G is zero. Since if I assuming some kind of non-degenerate condition, transverse condition for G, this condition, partial derivative of G equal to zero, actually will imply all the XI equal to zero. That will show up again. To define GIT coefficient, we need to pick a polarization, which is the character of your group G, in this case is a C star. This is just given by integer, map Z to Zn. You can go ahead, first construct your GIT coefficient. There are two cases, depends on the sign of n here. N greater than zero is called a geometric phase or collabial phase. The unstable locus, namely the points you want to remove, are exactly x equal to zero, or the x coordinate equal to zero. So you remove them from V, then you obtain this space here. Total space of a Weyl-Pugliese space is O minus D. The critical locus corresponding to the first component, this component here. The second component, as I said, this condition here will imply will xi equal to zero. This is exactly the points you want to remove. So the second component is not inside here. The first component is exactly your sort of collabial hypersurface. We already know in the example quintessential. The other cases is your character is negative, namely this integer here n is negative. If that happens, then we're headed to the line of Gensler phase. The unstable locus is p equal to zero. So you remove the p, then your second factor becomes c star. You use the c star rescale your second variable p to the one. You obtain some kind of orbit four. I already talked about this before for quintessential. Then the critical locus here, because p is not zero, so you look at the then so this component doesn't apply. You only have this component. So then this just one point is a critical point, just zero, an origin of CN. It's also compact. One point is compact. So those are a good model. The Landau-Ginzburg collabial correspondence, as I say, this is a conjecture about connecting the Gormala theory to the FGR double theory by some kind of unlimited continuation. Then you can sort of realize this, engaging in the sigma model by vary the parameter R. This is sort of by the wall crossing. This is actually the series of wall crossing. And we'll talk about in the next slides. Before I do that, I just mentioned briefly, you can easily generalize the picture to the complete section. So for example, you have a K equation. Each equation, you put a new variable equal P, sine a proper degree, your W just simply the P1, G1, P2, G2, there's something called the K-tree. It's also a kind of classical in algebraic geometry. Up to now, most of the study is about a total variety. This actually has some interesting phenomena in the non-abelian case as well, which I sort of predict will become coming to focus next couple of years. So I couldn't resist to talk about one example here. This is a kind of one example of so-called Pfaffian variety. This case, initially, you want to consider so-called complete section of Grossmannian, say G27. We know how to do this. To construct complete section or hypersurface of Grossmannian, there are several ways to do this. Kind of coordinate freeway is it looks some kind of ample line bundle of a Grossmannian. You pick some kind of section, blah, 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 and so on. It's a more geometrical to do this. It's a that ample line bundle actually give you embedding into the Weyl Grossman into some kind of projective space. It's called the Proker embedding. Yeah. They now example we are interested is just a linear hypersurface of Grossman. Namely the intersection of a Grossman with a linear hyperspace, linear space. You can sort of construct the gauge linear circuit model in the same way as like a hypersurface of a projective space. You know, whenever you have a hypersurface, you have an additional variable you call P. Since you have a similar meaning hypersurface, so you have a similar meaning P variable here. Now the GIT quotient for Grossman is a matrix 2 by 7, but quotient out by GL2. Then now I'm picking up my R charge is I have a P variable, have R charge 1, or other have R charge 0. Well, it's kind of worthwhile actually to just look at the formula here. You can write down the Proker coordinates of Grossman very explicitly. So what is the Proker coordinates? Well, it's just this is a 2 by 7 matrix whose have maximum rank, namely rank 2. So you pick a you pick any 2 by 2 minor, you computer determinant. This is actually the Proker coordinates. Then the equation, your linear hypersurface is a linear equation. So the Bij, and then now you have some kind of linear coordinate there. Your W is Pj, Fj, just like you used to do. Then this model, if you look naively, actually it's very similar to like a quintet. They also have two different chamber or two faces. There's a geometric face. Where unstable locus is something, is a matrix whose rank is strictly less than 2. You take them out, you quotient by GL2, this you obtain the Grossman in G27. On top of that, the P variable is a total space of O minus 1. Again, your computing section is a critical point of your superpotential. Now, what is interesting, more interesting in this case is this analogous of Nander-Ginzburg phase, where your character is negative. There, you know, initially it's very similar. The unstable locus is a p variable equal to 0. You take them out, you'll get a p7. Then all this other variable will appear as some kind of bundle or p7. The critical points there is the entire p7. But what is different here from Tor variety is a stable isotropic group is no longer finite group. Actually, you can check this case, the isotropic group is SU2, something. Kind of continuous group. So this variety here, yeah, is or this stack is Artin stack. It's not a demon, have a very large isotropic group. Then used to be, if you run into this situation, the technique we have to extract invariants called virtual Fermion cycle just fail. We don't know how to construct some theory to extract number out of here. You know, for last 20 years, if you run into this situation, you just give up. Well, this is a bad situation. Then we don't want to consider. But what is interesting is a physicist is mostly Horry and his collaborator. They actually studied the situation using some kind of physical method. You can sort of formulate it. What the physicists say into the following question. Namely, there should be some theory. There should be some kind of new technique applied to this example, enable you to extract number, even in this situation. Once you define the numbers, the number should localize to the Fabian in the P7. Namely, this number should be the same as Gomu invariant of a Fabian. Now, Fabian is a so-called degenerate locus of a kind of skew symmetric matrix. Since I talk about this, let me just say a few words about sort of like a geography of a collabial manifold. Initially, I mentioned we have millions of the maximum correctly that I would only actually 60,000 collabial threefold. Those are hyper or complete section total already. If you are not interested in story, actually interested to computation. Among those 60,000 examples, only 14 has been computed extensively. Those are so-called one-parameter model. The other Calabi three-four where Hodge number H11 is equal to one, or on the B model is H21 equal to one. Yeah. Those numbers, Zinnian's paper has been written by this number, the two computation, very detailed computation has been done. But if you go beyond that, they immediately become very difficult. So I actually have students try to compute the so-called Peacock-Fuchs equation for some two-parameter model. Those are like complex integration of P2 cross P1. There's also some class examples studied by Bosse and Bozan. They turns out to write down a full set of Peacock-Fuchs equation, he needs to use a supercomputer. It's kind of amazing, actually, a graduate student project, he actually get a time on the university supercomputer. It's very non-computation. After that, I sort of understand why even physicists only want to do one parameter model. It's because beyond that, just too complicated, too hard. During the last couple of years, those example one parameter model increased from 14 to 20, 23 or 22. These new examples are coming in such a fashion. They are so-called, like Fafian is it's called the determinant variety, some kind of degenerate locus of generally it would be like a Weyl-Piaget space or some kind of Grossmanning. So those are highly non-continuous actually. We actually don't have many techniques to access its information about, for example, computer is a Gomot invariance or even harder the computer Foucault category. This gauge linear second model is one model hopefully to help you to access this non-computing intersecting example or Calabi-Yau three-four. I thought this would be kind of interesting. By the way, we actually don't know yet what are the minimum manifold for those 20 some example. This is so new. Has been around for 2 or 3 years. Okay, so in the remaining half an hour, I'm supposed to tell you how to construct module space. This actually was my original title. Basically we want to use this group action. Can I write something here? Yeah, just one. I just need like a 2 or 3 minutes. Okay. So, as I mentioned, the Gomot invariance is about a map from a Riemann surface into your Calabi-Yau manifold. I'm only interested in the Calabi-Yau continuous section of a GIT coordinate. For example. Like a quintet. So this will be in a projective space P4. I want to write them as I have a presentation like this. So now I want to actually use this this group action. So one way to kind of rephrase this map is then this guy has a O1 here. Now the coordinate function, coordinates actually are the section of this bundle. So you have this x1, x5 is a section section of this bundle. Is h0 of O1. Then this map can be reinterpreted as the following data. You pull back this bundle. So L is a bundle. You pull back O1. So this is a nine bundle. Then together with this coordinate function, this will be in three interpreted section. So this x1, x5 will be a section of L. Okay? So that's sort of starting points of gauging in the sigma model. Instead of looking at the map, I'm going to consider some bundle together with the section. If you want to go in backwards, in mapping the projective space, it means you are assuming this is not always zero. Then you can going back and forth. You map, give this data. This data also give you a map. So that's a kind of big starting points of a gauge linear sigma model. So now we can go back. Okay, so as I say, you know, there are two kind of basic ingredients here. The first is a you talk about bundle with a section. I will explain where this comes from. You're only looking for map, but you instead recapture that information by using this group action, this bundle. This bundle coming from the sister action on the ambient space. Then section will give you some kind of map. Now the stability condition corresponding to this condition here, or you see in the back, this XR are not zero, are not a simultaneous to zero. But we want to sort of consider a more sophisticated stability condition because I have this parameter R, I want to move from minus infinity to plus infinity. So XR are not a simultaneous zero will be something at infinity. I'm also looking for other kind of stability condition. So this is the most subtle information here is captured by some kind of stability condition. Now let me look at either case. It's a toroid with an integral R charge. Actually, I'm going to even looking for even more simpler case, just a hypersurface of a wave projector space. This is my gauge linear sigma model. Is quotient of Cn by cross C by C star with R charge 0, 0, 1. The first part of data, meaning bundle together with section, is a very simple recipe actually. So you have a curve, you have a pre-stable mark curve. Now the C star action which define the wave projector space give you a sequence of line bundle. So you start from the a single sister action that gave you some kind of principal line sister bundle of a curve. Then from there, you generate a sequence of a line bundle, each corresponding to each coordinate of the Cn cross C, which is basically the power of your fundamental line bundle. The power is given by the weights of your sister action. It's a C1, Cn, and minus D. So this coming out of your G action. Now R charge is another sister action. This gives you another sequence of line bundle. They coming out of omega log. So the curve, this Riemann surface, has a cotangent bundle. Algebraic geometry prefer use the so-called dual line shift. Now you can looking for also nodal curve. Then turns out it's more convenient you have also log structure and mark points. Well, you can ignore that at this moment. Your first line bundle, you have one fundamental line bundle, C star bundle, coming from C star action. And the second one, you have another fundamental line bundle, is already fixed, is omega log, or the cotangent bundle of curve. Then again take its power according to its R charge. Then of course here I'm assuming R charge is integral, so I can take a power. You say if it's a fraction, let's get a bit subtle what I mean. The fraction of power, and the whole picture become a little bit more subtle. Yeah. But if it's an integral R charge, then that's it. So you have a two sequence of line bundle. Then you take its tensor product, and you get this line bundle here, the sequence of line bundle. Now my original coordinate function will become section of this sequence of line bundle. You see, for each coordinate, I have a line bundle. Now, so this is a full set of data here. I have a curve, I have a line bundle, of section, the section, section of this sequence of nine. So it's pretty simple so far. Now what is most subtle is the stability condition. So far actually my definition is independent from which chamber I choose. I did not choose a polarization or anything like that. They, now to talk about stability condition, then I needed to actually first pick a polarization, then go to the corresponding GH quotient and you want to consider. So let me here two examples here. The stability condition actually depends on a parameter, which we call epsilon, can go from infinity to zero plus is a arbitrary, means arbitrarily small. Zero go to epsilon go to zero. The most important case is infinity and a sort of infinitesimally zero, but intermediate zero is a little more involved. So let me, but it's kind of it's constrained the same way, in a similar way. So let me just give you a description in those two cases. Okay, so let's start from the positive phase. That's like a geometric phase where the critical locus is your collabial hypersurface. There, the GI quotient unstable locus is all the x variable at zero. So now let me give a name. For stable map, assuming xi is not always zero, never simultaneously zero. But I'm going to relax that condition. I allow them to be zero at some point. Those points I call the base point. The base point is exactly the section. Those sections could be zero, but I'm assuming them to be away from node points, from mark points, and so this is kind of common assumption if you are studying component theory. Now I have to tell you what is stability condition. As I say, this depends on a parameter. If you're arbitrarily small, arbitrarily big. For arbitrarily small one, arbitrarily small one is no condition. Maybe I should start from arbitrarily big. Arbitrarily big, first, you don't allow any base point. Namely, your section given by x variable is always never zero. This actually define map, define a map into projective space. Now, the only tiny little bit of stability condition is a so-called rational tail. Rational tail is a component of a domain curve where there's only one spatial point, namely, if you count the mark or null points, there's only one of them. You require this to be, this component have a positive degree. This will imply, for example, like an isotropic group of your map is finite, for example, blah, 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 and so on. But this is not exactly the same. You know, actually, people use this other condition by assuming the object have finite automorphism. Then it turns out this is a different condition. So I do want them to have positive degree here. For like hyperspace or projective space, you can check this is exactly a stable map module space. So you sort of recover a stable map as a module space when epsilon with the stability condition is infinity. This other extreme where epsilon is very very small, then there you have no condition on the base point. You can have arbitrary number of base point, but they instead you have some condition on those rational tail in the following way. So for any component of a curve, you're assuming omega log tensor is some power, arbitrary small power epsilon is ample. So this actually means there's no rational tail. So you get rid of rational tail. For people who are doing computation component theory, we all know why this computation is so complicated. Part of the reason is exactly caused by this kind of rational tail. If you have a theory where there's no rational tail, now generally you get an easier answer, you get a better formula. When this kind of condition come up, people are kind of excited about it, because that means all invariants should be appearing in some simple form. So this is in a geometric phase. Now let's go to non-algebraic phase. Okay. So this is a stability condition. I'm sorry. Now the module space itself again. Let me first talk about infinity. I have a curve line bundle with a bunch of section called S. This is the corresponding to X variable. I also have this kind of annoying variable I call P. This stability condition have nothing to do with P. It's just a stability condition on S variable on the geometric phase. So I actually obtain a stable map into projective space. So far, there's no hypersurface here at all, just projective space. But I have this kind of extra P there as a section of L to the minus D tensor with omega log. Then turns out this modular space has been studied also before by Huanliang Chen and Jun Li. They call this a modular space of stable map with P field. But this will come in later on when we try to construct like a so-called virtual boundary cycle extract invariants. But so far, the modular space level, they were just it's kind of dummy variable there, did not interact with other variables. Now, for zero plus theory, again, P has is kind of separated. A condition solely on those xi, what I call xi variable, then you have this condition, you know, there's no watching tail, the mark point, the node, the base point can be arbitrary. This is something called stable quotient. Has been also studied by people like Wahoo Pen and Penny a couple years back. Again, P just hanging out there. The P will come in when you try to construct a virtual boundary cycle. This is a so-called geometric phase. Then this so the Nyland-Gunther phase, this is also a simple modular space. Unstable locus for the Nyland-Gunther phase is P equal to zero. Again, if P is if you allow P to be zero, then I call them base point. If you have a line bundle section, then zero, of course, is almost determined. After scaling, actually determine that section. So this information P here is completely encoded in its divisor. Because this is a homomorphic section, so this is kind of effective divisor. Then now my P is a section here, is a section here. So this is given by some kind of effective divisor. So I can rewrite it. My modular condition as L to the minus D tensor with omega log is isomorphic to some kind of effective divisor. Then you rewrite this as omega L to the D isomorphic to omega log, then twist down by an effective divisor. If you don't have this D, that's exactly the case. If so, equal infinity means low base point. It means that P is never zero, so the D is empty. You just get a condition L to the D is isomorphic to omega log. This is something called a spin curve. This is a condition proposed by Witten also quite a long time ago. This new theory, with this divisor divider there, some kind of weight spin curve there. Then, as I would mention, in if so equal infinity means D is empty. There's no base point. You get this condition. This is the origin of FJW theory. Then for general epsilon, there's some kind of weighted FJW theory. Then here, namely, when you wear the epsilon here, the theory remains to be the same except a certain value. You can actually calculate which value they change. It happens exactly on 1 over d. And both Nyland-Gunther phase and a geometric phase. In physics, we sort of convention is you put a minus on the Nyland-Gunther phase. Then you arrive to this picture here. There's a whole line here. That's where this R varies in the Gauge-Witten equation. Then in the plus infinity, you obtain your Bohm-Mollen theory. And the minus infinity, you obtain your FJW theory. Now you try to vary this parameter. They have a wall on 1 over D on both sides. Then there's a very bad wall and zero. That's where you actually cross the GIT quotient, different chamber of GIT quotient, from a geometric phase to the Nyland-Gunther phase. Now we also have a fairly good understanding about what are the nature of this wall crossing. Well, in the sense of conjecture, if you look at the generating function, those wall, this kind of internal wall inside each GIT chamber. Your generating function just differ by change of variable. What is even better is when you go into this zero plus here, the generating function is largely written in the B model coordinates. So this picture, this gauge linear model, in some sense also contain B model as a part of data. So it happened actually linear zero here. That's the places where formula become very nice. You caused directly by the fact you don't allow any rational tail. Well, this is not very surprising, you know, because we are doing computation before. We all know that, you know, if you the rational tail is exactly the, something causes you trouble. So here's a nice picture. You vary from infinity, here is Gomovitan. You cross the wall, you head it to zero plus, near zero. You go to B model. Now you cross the zero. This is a, like a B model side of FGW theory. Then you're going backwards, then you head it to, all the way to FGW theory. Yeah. So for the internal wall, the generally function just differ by a change of variable here. I didn't write it in the conjecture, but I saw it in words. Near zero, you actually go into the B model coordinates. Then this part of conjecture has been people are actually working very intensive right now, is closely down. So if you're interested, don't do it, because when you you know, when you understand problems, people put it back paper already. But the second part of conjecture is that when you cross zero, this is a GIT wall. The conjecture is a general function is different by analytic continuation, was something called quantization or some path transformation. There's some kind of differential operator you have to apply. This second wall crossing conjecture is completely unknown. Nobody had any idea. So if you want to work on that, do this problem, the second problem.
But what do you mean by quantization of simplistic
transformation? So the generating function here, that turns out, then turns out, you know, even you under the continue, say, generating function from the component to this side, it's not quite a generating function for FGW theory. You have to apply another differential operator. This differential operator is written in some kind of canonical way. We call quantization and path transformation. The data here, we actually know exactly what the differential operator are. It's building out the general zero data. So the conjecture is completely explicit. You just have to prove it. So you can either prove or disprove it. You know, I don't like some conjecture, you know, you cannot disprove it. I have 10 minutes, so let me flip over some other example. So I want to say something about words pick on me, right? So when I consult this example, I have this funny p there, did not interact with the stability condition. They come in on the second stage when you try to extract numbers, construct a so-called virtual function cycle. This is another technique. So before I apply that, so let me just state the theorem here. You consider this module space. This data like curve, nine bundle with a bunch of section. This carries so-called two-term purple abstraction theory. And is the name of a stack. But unfortunately, this is not compact. Our technique to construct invariance almost works, except this is not compact. Those are just technical words about, you know, how do you get the numbers? We need something to be, we need one more condition to say this to be compact. Then we can say, well, you get a number. But unfortunately, it's not compact. But rather inside here, it's a subspace which is compact. Those are the object where the image is in a critical locus. That's where this assumption of a critical locus to be compact is very important here. Now, to go from this open subspace to a compact subspace, this is a technique called the cosection, localized virtual class. It's sort of developed a couple years back by Kim and Lee, kind of adapt into the into Lionel Gunn's model. By Chen, Huailiang Chen, Weiping Li, and Jun Li. So the essence of that construction is this. So you have some kind of modular problem where, say, this is your abstraction sheaf. Then cosection is a map from your abstraction sheaf into trivial bundle. Now you call it degenerate locus is a point on your modular space where the cosection is zero. Well, afterwards, that's called degenerate locus. Right? Then there's a technique called cosine localized virtual class enable you to construct a class on the degenerate locus of this cosine. Yeah, so if your degenerate locus is compact, then your business, you get some kind of homology class in this compact subspace. So this is a general scheme. Now, how do you apply to our situation? Well, that's exactly where this superpotential comes in. Let me jump this. This is some about mark points and insertion. You say, I have this superpotential. Now your computer is a derivative, right? Just like your computer critical locus. This is kind of miraculously, this derivative of a superpotential can be interpreted as a cosection for this modular problem. It's actually pretty amazing, actually, when Huayang first kind of showed me. You write down, it's right there. You don't have to do anything. So this piece of data did not appear when you try to construct modular space. Can be naturally interpreted as a cosection from your modular problem, and whose degenerate locus is exactly where the compact subspace are. So that's it. You apply this technique, then you get some kind of number. You can go on to show it satisfy your axiom of Gormovitz theory like gluing and so on. That's where you get the numbers. We are trying to compute them. In the last few minutes, let me actually make some comments about the other perspective and maybe future generalization of this stuff. We pick a kind of stability condition, a special kind of stability condition. There's no reason you have to stick with this stability condition. Maybe you can pick some other stability condition. In fact, there are other interesting stability condition. For example, like a Chen Yi Li, they use the stability condition. Assuming automorphism group of objects is finite. This is one kind of stability condition. They have been very successful to doing this in some example. Another interesting stability condition is coming from stable bundle. This epsilon stability condition actually is kind of very different from the stable bundle of a curve, what we used to do. Yeah. Then people also try to adopt the stability condition from a old day in stable bundle of a curve in this situation. By Kim and his collaborator, there are also some very interesting features for that stability condition. Who knows, maybe some other stability condition as well. I think each one of them should be useful in, for some purpose. Now looking into the future, there's a lot of people try to, doing this for Tor already right now. If you are kind of new to this subject, maybe it's not worth competition for those guys, right? Let's do something that people haven't done yet. That's when you run into the situation. The group is not abelian, the GIT quotient. There's a rich story here, like a gross mining, fried variety, quiver, blah, 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 and so on. This subject is literally connected to, for example, like a geometric representation theory, AGT conjecture, and a gauge theory duality, and so on. On the one hand, other, I would mention, this also access to new example, which is highly non-computing session, such as the Pfaffian variety, determinant variety. The general picture on this category is evolving right now. It's evolving right now. So myself, I also try to understand the general picture, maybe propose some problem. I think something very interesting happened here. There's a reason, some recent work by Okunkov on the Deformation model. The physics going back to Nikosov. I think that stuff also should be kind of fit into this picture here, like connection to geometric representation theory. We don't quite understand yet the precise connection. So something very interesting is happening here. I guess it's kind of exciting. to work on this subject right now. Thank you.